I'm going to talk about a breakthrough in algebra, which involves group theory. So in order to tell you what this breakthrough is, I need to begin by telling you what a group is, or at least reminding you if you've heard about groups before. What groups are? Well, a group is, first of all, a set of, think of them as numbers. In general, they won't be numbers, but think of them as numbers and you won't go too far wrong. One of them is distinguished. I'm going to call it one. And in addition, on this set, we have a binary operation. Again, for the purposes of fixing your thoughts, think of it as multiplication. In general, it won't be multiplication, but you won't go far wrong if you think of it as multiplication. This system has to satisfy certain rules if we are to call it a group. Here they are written down. I'm going to ask that x times yz is equal to xyz for all x and y and z that are members of the group. That's known as the associative law. And it just comes naturally when you're thinking of numbers. 2 times 3 times 5, 6 times 5, is the same as 2 times 3 times 5, 2 times 15. They're both equal to 30. Then I want this distinguished number 1 to behave like 1 for multiplication. If I take any number x, any member of the group x, multiply it by 1 on either side, I should get x back again. And then I should be able to divide. For every number x of the set, there should exist a number y, a member y, such that x times y is the identity and y times x is the identity. In other words, y is what we would normally write as 1 over x or as x inverse. So that's what a group is. It's a system of numbers. You mustn't just think of numbers themselves. It's a system of numbers. And what we're going to try to do in group theory is compare different groups. Well, that's what a group is. To say a bit more about what it is, I'd like to tell you what a group is for. And what groups are for is measuring symmetry. What do I mean by that? Well, the famous example is that of a square. How do we measure the symmetry of a square? Well, you can see that it looks symmetrical in an informal sort of way. To measure its symmetry, I use a group. Think of this square. Think of what you can do to the square in order that it is apparently unchanged. It's these operations that are the members of my group. For example, I can rotate it through a quarter of a turn, or through a half a turn, or through three quarters of a turn, or I can do nothing to it. There are four operations that I can perform on this square. If I perform any one of those while your eyes are closed and you open your eyes, you will not know that I've done anything at all to the square. So this is what I think of as a symmetry operation. I can also, of course, take the square and turn it over. Reflect it, if you like, in its north-south axis. Or I could have reflected it in its east-west axis, or in a diagonal, or in the other diagonal. There are, in fact, in this case, 8 different operations that I can apply to the square while your eyes are closed, and when you open your eyes, you will not be able to detect that I've done anything to the square. Those eight operations tell us that the square looks the same from eight different directions, if you like. It's this looking the same, even although I've done something to the square, which measures a symmetry of the square. What is the group that I'm talking about? The group is the collection of objects. So in this case, the members of the group are not numbers, they are symmetry operations, and for the square, there are eight of them. I said a group has to have an identity element, a unit element. What is that? Well, that is the operation of just doing nothing to the square. You close your eyes, I leave the square alone, you open your eyes again, I've done nothing to it. For a group, we also required a binary operation. In this case, the binary operation is what's known as composition of symmetry operations. If I do one symmetry operation and then follow it by another symmetry operation, the composite of those two, the two that I did while your eyes were closed, come to the equivalent of just one. So there is a multiplication on symmetry operations. The fact that it's associative is not hard to see. The fact that doing nothing is the identity operation is not hard to see. The fact that every operation has an inverse, namely go back again, is also not hard to see. So the symmetry operations form a group, and it is that group that measures the symmetry of the square. And formally, if you want a way of formally describing the fact that the symmetry of a square is different from that of a circle, you can actually look at the groups. In the case of the square, the group has eight symmetries. In the case of a circular disk, it has infinitely many symmetries. I can rotate it through any angle at all while your eyes are closed, and when you open your eyes, you will not know that I have moved the disk. So, we measure the symmetries of objects, geometrical objects, algebraic objects, all sorts of objects. We measure them using groups. How do we describe groups? There are many ways of doing that. I want to mention only two. Perhaps the most famous, and certainly the one that people learn earliest when they're first starting group theory, is by means of what is called nowadays a Cayley table, simply a multiplication table for the group. Here is an example. I have a group that has six members in it, and I've called them 1, that's the distinguished element that is required in every group, A, B, C, D, and E. And here's a multiplication table for the group. For example, B times B is equal to A. C times A is equal to E. Notice that A times C is equal to D. So here we have an example of what's called a non-commutative group. It is not always the case that when you multiply two members of the group, x and y, you will find that xy equals yx. That may be true for some members of the group, it may be false for others. Here's an example of a Cayley table of a particular group. I have written firmly in red, it's not recommended. There are two problems with it, description of a group by a Cayley table. Two problems. One, you'll see later, that some groups are far too large to be reasonably described by their Cayley tables. But another problem is that you cannot check, at least you cannot check very easily, that the multiplication table satisfies the conditions for a group. Checking that the one acts as a one is, of course, very easy. You can see one times anything is that same thing. Anything times one is that same thing. Similarly, you can check very easily that inverses exist in a table like this. What you can't check very easily is the associative law. In this particular case, checking that x, y, z is x, y, z for any three x and y and z is not going to be too difficult. There are, after all, only 216 possibilities for the triple x, y, and z. But for larger tables, it can be very hard indeed. A much better way of describing a group is to describe it as the group of symmetries of some structure S. That structure S may be a geometrical structure like the hexagon or the disc that I showed you before. Or it might be an algebraic structure. It might be, in some parts of mathematics, a topological structure, or, well, there are all sorts of structures that it may be. And we'll come across some examples later in this lecture. I'd like to spend just a few moments discussing an important example of a group. Start with a prime number p, 2 or 3, 5, 7, any of those numbers, 65,537, one of your favorite prime numbers. By this open face z subscript p, I shall mean the system of integers modulo p. If you like, you can think of these as being the integers 0, 1, 2, up to p minus 1. So the system has p members. It has both addition and multiplication. Addition, you take two of your numbers, add them in the usual way, and then simply take the remainder when you divide by p. Multiplication is exactly the same. Take two of those numbers, multiply them in the usual way, take the remainder modulo p. That's an arithmetic system. As a matter of fact, addition forms an example of a group. Multiplication of the non-zero members is another example of a group. But that's not the point I want to make. I want you to think of those as being numbers, just in the same way as fractions or real numbers are numbers. And then to consider the collection of 2 by 2 matrices, A, B, C, D, where those coordinates, those coefficients of the matrices A and B and C and D, they are to be integers modulo p. And I'm going to put on the constraint that the determinant of this matrix, the so-called determinant, that is to say A times D minus B times C, is equal to 1. Now, whenever you see multiplication or subtraction or equality, you are to think of that in the system of integers modulo p. That collection of matrices is to be the collection of members of my group. The identity matrix, where A and D are equal to 1 and B and C are 0, so the matrix 1, 0, 0, 1, is the identity of the group. And what about the binary operation? The binary operation is to be matrix multiplication. You may not have met matrix multiplication, and I do not want to linger on it, but let me just tell you for a moment what it is, or remind you if you have met it before. If I have two 2x2 matrices, in this case, A1, B1, C1, D1, and A2, B2, C2, D2, multiply them together in this way, the product is a 2x2 matrix. In the northwest corner, it has A1, A2 plus B1, C2. In the northeast corner, it has A1, B2 plus B1, D2. In the southwest corner, C1, A2 plus D1, C2. And in the southeast corner, it has C1, B2 plus D1, D2. But I must remind you that all this arithmetic is happening in the integers modulo p. So that is a complete description of a set and a multiplication upon it. And it's not too hard an exercise to prove that that set is a group. Well, that's a much more complicated group than any of the others that I've shown you before, the symmetry group of a square or a circular disk. But it is a very important group, and it is groups like this that I'm going to be talking about when talking about simple groups. As I've said, we're interested not so much in the details of the algebra, the multiplication within any particular group. What we're interested in is comparing various different groups. For example, we might look at the order of a group. The order is simply a technical term for the number of members of the group. I'm going to be interested only in finite groups, like the group of symmetries of the square that I showed you before, or the group that I called SL2P a moment ago, the group of 2x2 matrices with determinant 1 over the integers modulo p. Those groups are finite. The group of rotations of a circular disk is infinite. I'm going to exclude infinite groups from this discussion, even although I must tell you they're very interesting indeed. If we want to analyze a group, we begin by considering its subgroups. What do I mean by a subgroup? I mean this: it's a subset of the group G, which is closed. And here I'm using closed in a technical sense. What I mean by that is, first of all, it must contain the distinguished element that I've called 1. Secondly, for any two members, G and H, of the subset, capital H, I want to be sure that GH is also a member. Read this double arrow as implies, and what I'm interested in is the implication: if G and H are members of H, then also GH must be a member of H. Likewise, if G is a member of H, then its inverse must be a member of H. So that is what I mean by closure. H contains the unit, it's closed under multiplication, it's closed under inverse. And just as a matter of convenient notation, we would usually write H is less than or equal to G to mean that it is a subgroup in this sense. Amongst the subgroups, normal subgroups are of particular importance. We say that H is a normal subgroup if XH is HX for every member X of capital G. By XH, I mean the set of all elements x times a member of capital H. By capital HX, of course, I mean the set of all elements a member of capital H times the element little x. And what I'm asking for is that those should be the same set for any x in G. If you've done some group theory, you'll recognize that the sets little xh are the so-called left cosets of capital H and G. The sets capital HX are the right cosets of H and G, and what I'm requiring is that every left coset should be a right coset, and vice versa. I shall use the symbol introduced by Wieland about 30 years ago, a sort of triangle, underlined triangle, to indicate that H is a normal subgroup of G. What good are normal subgroups? Well, they're good for this. Notice that if I take the subset of G that consists just of the identity element alone, that certainly contains the identity element. It's certainly closed under multiplication, because if I take any two elements, that's one and one, multiply them together, I just get one back in the set. And the inverse of one is one. So this is a subgroup, and it's very easy to see that it's a normal subgroup. Likewise, the whole set G is a normal subgroup of G. These are the extreme subgroups, the smallest and the largest subgroup of G, and they are always normal subgroups. A group S is said to be simple if the only normal subgroups are the identity and the whole group. That is to say, if H is a normal subgroup of S, then H must be either the identity group or the whole of S. Where does the concept come from? Well, suppose we start out with a group G that is not simple. In that case, somewhere inside it we will find a normal subgroup that's not the identity and that is not the whole group. We can think of G as being composed of, not G, that's a misprint, but H. Let's correct that. H, and a so-called factor group, G over H. It's a bit difficult to describe what this is if you're not experienced in group theory, but simply think of it as being a sort of quotient. If you have a normal subgroup, then you can form a factor group, a quotient group, G over H. And the group G will be composed of those two groups. They're both of them smaller than G, the normal subgroup H and the factor group G over H. So, if we have a group that is not simple, we look for a normal subgroup in it. We find that normal subgroup H. We form the, as I said, so-called factor group G over H. We take each of these factors, H and G over H, and decompose them, if we can. Continue until you reach groups which I've called S1, S2, up to SK, which cannot be decomposed in this way. To say that they can't be decomposed is to say precisely that these are simple groups. So there's a strong sense in which every finite group is composed of simple groups. Furthermore, there is a theorem which evolved between 1868 and 1888, the Jordan-Hölder theorem, which says that if you start with a finite group G and decompose it, find a normal subgroup H, look at H, look at G over H, find normal subgroups in those, decompose them, carry on until you can do no more decomposition, you will have found what are called the composition factors. And the Jordan-Hölder theorem says that it doesn't matter in which order you do this decomposition, you will always get the same composition factors. It's very much a prime factorization theorem for group theory. Every finite group is composed of a unique collection of simple groups in just the same way as every integer can be uniquely decomposed into a product of prime numbers. For example, 60, 2 times 2 times 3 times 5. In this second part, what I want to tell you about is the great breakthrough, which was the classification of the finite simple groups. Let me start with some simple examples. Z sub p, the cyclic group of prime order p. How do I describe this? Well, one way is to think of it as the group of rotational symmetries of a regular p-gon. Here is a regular five-gon, regular pentagon. And what I'm talking about is the group of rotational symmetries. I can leave the pentagon alone. I can rotate it through a fifth of a turn, two-fifths of a turn, three-fifths, or four-fifths. I've got five operations I can do. If you like, if we think of one of those operations, the rotation through 2 pi by 5, as being an operation, let me call it A, then the operations are A squared, A cubed, A to the fourth, and A to the fifth, which is the identity, we're right back where we started. That is typical of a cyclic group. In fact, the additive group of the integers modulo p is a cyclic group of order p. Cyclic groups of order p have no non-trivial subgroups at all. The only subgroups are the identity subgroup and the whole group. And a fortiori, these are the only normal subgroups, and so certainly these groups are simple. The next group I want to tell you about is the group known as PSL2P. You saw SL2P before. I should tell you the L stands for linear. That tells us that this is a matrix group. The S was the condition that the determinant was 1. Do you remember I had AD minus BC equals 1? That's the determinant equals 1. This is the special linear group. The 2 tells us it's 2 by 2 matrices. The comma is a comma, I suppose. The P says we're working over the integers modulo P. The coefficients are integers modulo P. And finally, the capital P at the front here says projective special linear group of 2 by 2 matrices over the field with P elements. That is, I take SL2P. It has a normal subgroup consisting of plus and minus the identity, and I form the quotient group. The effect of that is simply that we identify plus and minus a matrix. We don't distinguish between a matrix and its negative. This group, PSL2P, the projective special linear group, dimension 2 over the integers modulo P, is a simple group as long as P is at least 5. These were some of the first simple groups to be discovered by Galois in 1832. Perhaps more famous simple groups are the so-called alternating groups. Take a number n greater than or equal to 5. Take the set 1, 2, up to n of integers, the first n integers. The alternating group of degree n is the collection of all even permutations of 1, 2, up to n. A permutation is simply a reorganization the operation of permuting the numbers 1, 2, up to n. Evenness is a technical condition that a permutation may or may not have. Every permutation can be obtained by a sequence of transposing two of the numbers 1, 2, up to n. If we can get the permutation as a product of an even number of transpositions, then that permutation is even. If not, not. We find that half of the permutations of 1 up to n are even permutations, the other half are odd. If we concentrate on the even permutations, we have the alternating group of degree n. If n is at least 5, then that is a simple group. So here we have three infinite families of simple groups. There are more than these that are known. I'd like to give you some indication of what they are. The complete list is far too complicated for a lecture of this kind. Nevertheless, I hope to give you a sort of survey of the known simple groups. First of all, there are a number of infinite families. In fact, there are 18 infinite families. There are the ones we've just seen, the cyclic groups of prime order, 2, 3, 5, 7, 11, 13, and so on. 65,537 comes in there somewhere. The alternating groups of degree n, when n is at least 5. These are quite big groups. Even the smallest of them, the alternating group of degree 5, has 60 members. Too big for it to be sensible for you to think of writing down a Cayley table. The alternating group of degree 6 has 360 members, and so on. The alternating group of degree n has n factorial divided by 2 elements. Quite a lot of elements. Then there are a number of families which nowadays are known by names like this: an of q, bn of q, there's cn of q, dn of q, e6, e7, e8, g2, and so on. And then there are the so-called twisted groups, 2an of q, 2b2 of q, and so on. There are 6 two-parameter families, a sub n of q, b sub n of q, and so on. Then there are 10 one-parameter families, like e8 of q, there's e7 of q, g2 of q, 2e6 of q, and so on. 16 families of these so-called groups of Lie type in all. Those families, some of them are called classical groups, some of them exceptional groups, some of them twisted groups. What are they? Well, an of q, these are groups very like the ones that you've seen before. I described to you PSL 2q. Those are the groups which, in this notation, are a1 of q. N here is a dimension. We could take, instead of 2x2 matrices, we could take n+1 by n+1 matrices. And instead of taking coefficients from the integers modulo p, we could take coefficients from what is called a finite field of size q. A finite field is simply a system in which we can add and multiply in exactly the same way as we add and multiply in the integers modulo p. And these groups, these families of groups, they're all of them analogues of the groups PSL 2p that I described to you before. We generalize by allowing the dimension to get bigger. The size of the matrices can be very big. The integers modulo p become replaced by an arbitrary finite field, but then essentially the same. Take matrices of determinant 1 modulo scalar matrices, modulo multiples of each other. And then the other families are similar. You could take, for example, orthogonal matrices, matrices where the matrix times its transpose is the identity matrix, or unitary matrices, or symplectic matrices. So all of these groups of Lie type, they are analogues of the groups of matrices that I showed you before. But they become very complicated, and as I've indicated, there are 16 families of them in all. Well, those are the infinite families of known simple groups. There are also another 26 so-called sporadic groups. I can't list them all for you. They get too complicated. The first ones to be discovered in 1861 were the so-called Mathieu groups, M11, M12, M22, 23, 24. The subscript there indicates that these are subgroups of corresponding alternating groups. M11 is a subgroup of the alternating group of degree 11. It's a group of permutations of 11 objects. M12, a group of permutations of 12 objects, and so on. M24 is a group of permutations of 24 objects. And for a very long time, these were the only sporadic groups known. Until in 1965, Zvonimir Janko, then in Australia, announced the discovery of a new simple group, now known as J1, Janko's first group. He's got four groups named after him. Quite a small group by modern standards. Its order is 175,560. And that was the first of 19 other, 21 groups that were discovered between 1965 and 1981. There are 19 groups I'm not telling you about. And finally, the Fischer-Grice monster, whose existence was indicated by Fischer and Grice independently in 1973. Bernd Fischer working in Bielefeld in Germany, Bob Grice working in Michigan, in Ann Arbor in Michigan. In all, as I've said, 26 sporadic groups that do not fit into those 17 or 18 infinite families. Just to give you some idea of the size of these things, the smallest of the sporadic groups is the Mathieu group M11. Its order in factorized form, which is the way it comes out in group theory, is 2 to the 4th times 3 squared times 5 times 11, which is 7,920. It's very small by modern standards, but it's far too big for this group to be described by a Cayley table. The Fischer-Grice monster, its order is 2 to the 46 times 3 to the 20 times 5 to the 9, 7 to the 6, 11 squared, 13 cubed, 17, 19, 23, 29, 31, 41, 47, 59, 71. Multiply all those together, and what you get is about 8 times 10 to the 53. It's an enormous group. Can't be described by a Cayley type table. But it's described as the automorphism group, the symmetry group of a certain structure. In this particular case, it's an algebraic structure, which is why I've called it A. It's in fact an algebra, a vector space with a multiplication upon it. And the dimension of this space is 196,884. So we come to the breakthrough. And I'd like to describe the breakthrough in this way. It is the theorem that any finite simple group is one of those in the list of known simple groups. And when I say it is one of those in the list of known simple groups that I've described, the 18 infinite families and the 26 sporadic groups. When I say it is, what do I mean? I mean it's, in technical terms, isomorphic to one of those groups. That is to say, you can relabel the members of this finite simple group so that the multiplication is the same as in one of those standard groups. It's a tremendous theorem. The proof was perhaps completed in about 1980. I believe that all the ideas were there and most of the details were there. The whole project to prove this theorem had been orchestrated by Daniel Gorenstein in the 1960s and 70s, and the final parts of the proof, or main parts of the proof, were produced by Michael Aschbacher, but many, many other people contributed. There was a correction, which I'll tell you about a little later, that has just been announced. To try to give you some idea of the scale of this achievement, let me go through a very brief history of the theory of simple groups. Évariste Galois, in a letter that he wrote on the night before he went out to be shot in a duel at the end of May 1832, gave the definition of a simple group. There wasn't really any group theory around at that time. He was way ahead of his time, a lad of 20, shot in a duel. 1870, nearly 40 years later, Camille Jordan wrote the Traité, a 600-page book, essentially a commentary on the work that the young Galois had written before he died in 1832. And in that Traité, Jordan focuses on the importance of the notion of simplicity. He proves, though not quite correctly, the simplicity of the alternating groups. He proves the simplicity of the groups PSLDP, the projective special linear groups of D by D matrices over the integers modulo P, and various other groups, the symplectic groups, some orthogonal groups over prime fields. And between 1870 and 1901, gradually the list of known groups grew. The five sporadic Mathieu groups were discovered. Various of the other classical groups, orthogonal groups, unitary groups were discovered and listed. From 1892 to 1904, mathematicians like Otto Hilde in Germany, Georg Frobenius in Germany, William Burnside, who was then professor at Royal Naval College in Greenwich, they were producing classification theorems. For example, Burnside proved in 1904 that a simple group must have either prime order or at least three different primes dividing its order. Then there was a bit of a pause, but in 1956, Claude Chevalley showed how the so-called continuous groups, the Lie groups that were important in physics, had analogues for finite groups. And shortly after that, the system that he proposed was modified to include the so-called twisted types. And by 1962, that list of 16 families of groups of Lie type that I gave you before was complete. In 1963 came the first really great breakthrough when Walter Feit and John Thompson published a proof of what's now known as the Feit-Thompson theorem, which tells us that simple groups of odd order, simple groups with an odd number of elements, are just those that have a prime number of elements, the cyclic groups of prime order. Between 1960 and 1980, a wealth of new classification techniques came in. Between 1965 and 1980, 21 new sporadic groups were discovered. And it all came together in 1980, the classification essentially completed. What about the present and the future? The first great task that has occupied Daniel Gorenstein and various of his colleagues in Rutgers University and other parts of the world is the project called Revisionism, Reworking the Proof. In its form in 1980, it was well over 10,000 pages long, an unbelievably long proof of one theorem. And of course, in 10,000 pages, you must expect there to be gaps, errors, slips. Worse than that, it was discovered about 4 years ago that one piece of the classification, the so-called classification of quasi-thin groups, which it had been believed had been completed, may have been completed, but only half of that particular piece of the classification was published. Well, this year it's been announced that Aschbacher took up the challenge and has completed the classification of the quasi-thin groups. Even so, I believe there must be further gaps. But I also believe that we have the techniques, that any gap really should be thought of as a slip, that we can fill it in. So I believe that the classification of the simple groups is complete. But of course, what's needed is to civilize the proof, bring it down to a reasonable size so that we can all understand it and believe it. But already we're exploiting the theorem. We're believing that the classification of the simple groups is complete, even if it isn't, of course, on the hypothesis that there are no new simple groups beyond those that we know. We can solve many of the old problems of group theory, of number theory, and many new areas are opening up. But these are too technical. They'll have to be the subject of a popular lecture at some time in the future.